From Corella to Ocracoke, news and events, sports and fishing, and special features. This is The Outer Banks with Ken Mann.
Good evening. Local law enforcement officials are asking for your assistance in helping find a missing woman. It's been extremely hot lately, and the heat has caused some problems. Don Ray will have a story about that. We've got some video of a blue marlin being caught and released in the Gulf Stream, and Wanchese decoy carver Nicky Sapone will be featured in the August edition of North Carolina Wildlife Magazine. These stories and more when we return in a moment.
The Daniels family has been in the seafood business long enough to know what fresh means. At Fisherman's Wharf, they specialize in generous portions of the freshest seafood available, prepared to your liking. Enjoy the view of Wanchese Harbor, and on occasion, watch the boats unload their catch. But by all means, before you leave, stop by Cap'n Malk's Seafood Market and take some fresh seafood home for later. Fisherman's Wharf, home of good folks and great food.
The Duck Pottery has come to Duck. Kellogg's and Duck has great gift ideas for home and garden. It's a new shop filled with gift ideas from far and wide. Kellogg's Duck Pottery is a collection of the novel, the unique, and the natural. Pottery, yardware, windmills, baskets, buckets, and woodcrafts priced right for the smart shopper. Whoever thought you'd find shopping like this? Kellogg's did, and they're bringing it to you. The Duck Pottery, located at Kellogg's in beautiful downtown Duck.
The folks at the Duchess of Dare restaurant invite you to join them for breakfast, lunch, and dinner daily. They feature an all-you-can-eat breakfast buffet on Saturday and Sunday, dinner buffet Tuesday through Saturday, and lunch buffet every Sunday. The Duchess of Dare also has a special children's menu, so mom and dad and the kids can all dine out at an affordable price. Located in historic downtown Mateo on Roanoke Island, enjoy a meal today, breakfast, lunch, or dinner at the Duchess of Dare restaurant.
Village Home Furnishings has the largest inventory of home furnishings on the Outer Banks. Let the professional staff of designers create an interior with brilliant colors of furniture, pictures, window treatments, and accessories for your beach cottage or home. After your choice has been made, let Village Home Furnishings deliver and set up your new furniture. Then all you need to do is show off your new home furnishings from Village Home Furnishings, milepost 11 on the bypass at Nags Head or milepost 6 on the bypass in Kill Devil Hills.
When I came here in 1947, I had never seen the ocean, never tasted shrimp, oysters, clams, crab, flounder, never caught a bluefish. And there was a place on the beach, Owens. We used to go there and load up on all that good stuff. So I go back a long ways with them. I lived in the Owens house for 2 summers, wrote my first monologue in their backyard. And I used to enjoy going to their restaurant and eating that fine food. And you know what? I still do.
Dare County Crime Line and the Kill Devil Hills Police Department are asking for your assistance in helping to locate a missing person. This is Lieutenant Jim Mulford.
Well, this week the Dare Community Crime Line and Kill Devil Hills Police are asking for assistance in locating a missing person. A young lady is named Deborah Ann Allen. She's a white female who lives in Kill Devil Hills and was last seen at her residence on East 3rd Street. This is on March 5th of this year. Deborah Ann Allen is 32 years old, 5 feet 8 inches tall, and weighs 145 pounds. She has blue eyes, and the natural color of her hair is brown, but she may have lightened it, tinted it light. Deborah also has a tattoo on her upper right arm of a set of scales, possibly of the zodiac sign. Anyone with information, please call Crime Line at 441-6003, or you can call 1-800-745-2746.
One speed limit from the north end of the beach to the south end of the beach. It's coming soon. The town of Nags Head has agreed to change their speed limits to 50 miles per hour. This is Town Manager Webb Fuller.
The impetus, I guess, was the fact that there's Jockey's Ridge area that seasonal change from 55 to 45. When the 45 went in, it changed from 45 to 55 right before the post office. And a new light went in at the post office. So there was a section where it was 45, then 55, then a stoplight. So at that time, the board started looking again at the possibility of, should we have a uniform 50-mile-an-hour throughout Nags Head? With the changes in traffic conditions, the board asked DOT to again address that. We looked at it internally. The recommendation has come from the police chief and the manager after some discussion with business community people and various citizens in the town, and we made a recommendation to the board that a 50-mile-an-hour uniform speed limit would be the best possible thing for Nags Head.
The 50-mile-per-hour speed limit should go into effect in the town of Nags Head in the next 3 weeks. It's been extremely hot lately, and the heat has caused some problems. Don Ray reports.
Although summer seemed to arrive a little late, most residents of Dare County were not exactly pleased that the mercury soared to record-breaking temperatures all along the Outer Banks. Northeastern North Carolina saw a heat wave that lasted too long. Workers did manage to continue on with their duties, although the pace was a bit slower than usual. Emergency medical services and medical facilities reported no fatalities, but did have to deal with heat-related patients.
Dare County Emergency Medical Services has responded to approximately 7 heat-related calls during this heat wave. We encourage everyone to stay just as cool as you can. Stay out of the heat. If you must go outside, be sure to drink plenty of fluids, limiting alcohol and caffeine. Wear light clothing. Stay near the shade if you can. If you feel that you are becoming overheated, seek shelter immediately. If you become ill, if you need medical assistance, dial 911.
Weather forecasters say cooler weather is just around the corner. I'm Don Ray reporting.
In the early 1950s, the best mode of transportation on Hatteras Island was by four-wheel drive Jeep. There were no paved roads. This is a picture of the Dare County Library Bookmobile making a stop at the U.S. Post Office in Waves, North Carolina. We'll be back with more news in a moment.
Why do so many people come back to eat at the Dunes restaurant? Maybe it has something to do with the great food, priced so that you can afford to take the whole family. The Dunes has a breakfast bar, lunch, and dinner specials, early bird dinner specials, and a fantastic salad bar. So bring the whole family to the Dunes. It's a local favorite. Oh yeah, don't forget your hat and t-shirt from the Dunes restaurant too. The Dunes, milepost 16 and a half, Nags Head.
Dennis Anderson and the Gravedigger is a real crowd pleaser as he travels the world as the monster truck champion. Based on the Outer Banks, the Gravedigger 4x4 Center is located on Westlake Drive in Killdevil Hills. So while you're on vacation, stop by and see how monster trucks are put together to compete on the monster truck circuit. And be sure to pick up a Gravedigger t-shirt or hat so when you get back home, you can say,
"Hey, I saw the Gravedigger while on vacation on the Outer Banks."
Seafood prepared the Etheridge way. That's what the Etheridge Seafood Restaurant is all about. Recipes handed down from one generation of Etheridges to another. Seafood fried or broiled, blackened dishes prepared and served in a variety of ways. And new from the Etheridge menu is seafood pizza, served with red or white sauce. And from the Irene Etheridge cookbook, seafood egg rolls that are an award-winning recipe. The Etheridge Seafood Restaurant, milepost 9.5 on the bypass in Killdevil Hills. Fresh seafood prepared the Etheridge way.
Yo, this here's Old Ralph from Macon Tracks. It's the 9.5 mile post on the bypass in Killdevil Hills. Hey, come on down to Macon Tracks where they have the only fully automated 2-minute car wash on the Outer Banks. And while you're there, fill up with Exxon gasoline, hey, get some ice and your favorite beverages, or try a couple of them world-famous hot dogs fixed just the way you like it. Pick up some suntan oil, sunglasses, or beach accessories. It's all at Macon Tracks. They've got everything to make a great day at the beach. And hey, when you get there, tell them Ralph sent you.
Fishing Unlimited is 5 reasons so many people come to the Outer Banks. It's fun for the whole family. It's the freshest seafood anywhere. It's fishing tackle. It's the Outer Banks Pier at milepost 18 and a half in South Nags Head. And our Roanoke Sound Fishing and Crabbing Pier on the Nags Head Matio Causeway. 2 great piers for one price. There's also a trained staff on hand at both locations to assist you. They do all of that so you'll have all the memories at Fishing Unlimited.
Welcome back. You may soon have to pay to visit the North Carolina Aquarium on Roanoke Island. Pamela Mamie reports.
The state-owned aquariums in North Carolina, including the one on Roanoke Island, could be charging entrance fees soon, under a proposal that has passed the state Senate. Officials have debated for years the idea of charging fees at the aquariums. Senator Mark Basnight, who sought the fee provision, said the only way under tough economic times to pay for maintenance and expansion of the aquariums is with such fees. Rhett White of the aquarium on Roanoke Island shared with us his feelings about the potential fees.
As to how we feel about it here at the aquarium, we have some mixed feelings, quite obviously. We would like to stay free to the public and reach as many people as we possibly could at no charge. We are an educational facility as well as a vacation-oriented facility or a tourist facility. But at the same time, we recognize a number of legislators have told us that we cannot expect to get funding for capital construction, for additions to the building, to carry out a master plan, unless we do charge a fee. So we do have some mixed feelings about it right now.
The fees collected at the aquarium on Roanoke Island would go towards an addition to the aquarium for a large open ocean tank with educational facilities. I'm Pamela Mamie reporting.
Where has Carolina 92 gone? Well, lightning struck the antenna and the cable and knocked the station off the air for a couple of days. Jeffrey G. has the details.
Carolina 92 is WNHW Nags Head. We must leave the air to make some repairs. About a week ago at this time, lightning struck our facility, and it's been up and down ever since. We're trying to get the situation straightened out. Thank you for all the calls of concern. We'll get it straight soon. If Carolina 92 WNHW is your favorite radio station, you may have been wondering where we've been. Well, when a severe thunderstorm recently passed over the Outer Banks, lightning hit our transmitter site. It damaged the antenna and cable, but the engineers felt like it was repairable. They were able to get the station back on the air for a couple of days at a reduced power. But eventually, it too failed, and the antenna and cable had to be taken down and replaced. Needless to say, you can't buy this type of cable and broadcast antenna at your local electronics store. So the antenna had to be sent to Maine to be rebuilt, and the cable had to come in from the eastern shore. Now, to make matters worse, the airplane flying the antenna to Maine got weathered in because of severe thunderstorms in New York. And almost another 24 hours went before it arrived at the factory to be refurbished. However, the parts have come in and things should be back to normal. Carolina 92 is WNHW Nags Head, back on the air after making some necessary repairs due to last Monday's lightning strike. Sorry for the inconvenience, the downtime, but there are some repairs that just can't be made while we're broadcasting. These are the Forrester Sisters.
We want to thank all of you for the many phone calls and the support that came in during the time we were off the air. It was sort of a disaster for us, but because of your support, we were able to get through it, and we're very appreciative. Back in July of 1947, disaster struck the Lost Colony. A fire destroyed the theater. Members of the staff, the actors, residents from Roanoke Island, friends from nearby towns, went to work immediately reconstructing the theater. The timbers were still smoking when work began. 6 days later, the drama was again reenacted. The performance was said to have been one of the most inspiring ever.
Hi, I'm RV. At Keepers Galley, we give you great value for your dollar. Would you take a look at these eggs? I sure like to see the size of that big chicken. Now I ask you, how can anything that big be called a shrimp? And folks, this is what we call a real seafood platter. And our prime rib, it's as big as the state of Texas. And you know what we say?
RV?
Oh no, Mr. Buzz, not the spoon, please.
Northeastern Protection Service has been providing security officers, private investigators, and fire and burglar alarm systems since 1982. They've now expanded their services to include a new retail outlet featuring OSHA-required safety equipment and supplies for police, fire, and rescue personnel and volunteers. Northeastern Protection will beat almost any deal on lights, ammo, and the supplies you need now. Visit their new location across from Midway, Texaco, or call 473-5551. Locally owned, Northeastern Protection, a respected name for a decade.
Let your dream soar at Kitty Hawk Kites. Since 1974, Kitty Hawk Kites has added adventure to the Outer Banks.
Kitty Hawk Kites has gifts for everyone, from whimsical to magical to fanciful. The largest selection of kites on the East Coast, with a trained staff to assist you in learning that kiting is a family sport. Famous t-shirt designs. Visit the new Flying Fish Camp, a true outdoor adventure wear store, at Kitty Hawk Kites, across from Jockey's Ridge in Nags Head.
In the 1920s, the Midgets began their seafood business and have continued through four generations. At Midget Seafood Restaurant, you'll find a selection of delectable and skillfully prepared seafood and steaks. They take great pride in their food preparation using age-old family recipes. Your hosts, Jeffrey Gray Midget and his son Jeffrey Wade, know that using only the freshest seafood available combined with good service keeps their customers coming back time and again. Midget Seafood Restaurant, upholding a 75-year tradition.
At Newman's Seashell and Gift Shop, mile post 13 and a half on the beach road in Nags Head, you can discover one of Nags Head's oldest and finest traditions in shopping. Their collection of native and exotic seashells has grown into the largest exhibit on the Outer Banks. Newman's offers thousands of seashells, plus locally made gifts, jewelry, and unique souvenirs. Take time to experience what has attracted generations of beachgoers. Lots of seashells at low prices. At Newman's Seashell and Gift Shop, mile post 13 and a half, Nags Head.
It's time now to take a look at some fishing pictures. We've been getting a lot of photographs from some of the marinas, the fishing piers, and the tackle shops, and from some of you individually, and we appreciate that. Last week we showed one picture that came to us from The Report. The Report is a sport fishing magazine, and we neglected to mention that, and we apologize, but we'll be telling you more about The Report in future programs. The first thing we're going to show you is some video of a blue marlin being caught in the Gulf Stream. It came to us from Kenny Pekrun, the captain of the Pollyanna. The marlin weighed about 250 pounds.
How's been tipping your pole, Dave? How's tipping the pole up here to me? Okay, Mark, you're clear on the leader if you have to let go.
Look at it.
Look at it.
Oh, man. Let me get him. Yeah! Beautiful, David.
Go ahead, Dave.
The angler was Dave Foster from Baltimore, Maryland, and Mark Mitchem was the mate on the Pollyanna when that big marlin was caught. This is Captain James Hutchinson and mate Jay Cudworth on the Vixen with a limit of dolphin caught out of Pirates Cove Marina. Here's Joe Heisler with a 73-pound, 11-ounce cobia he caught on the Outer Banks Pier. He's almost as tall as Joe. This is Captain Jay Robertson and Rick Rogers, his mate, with a catch of amberjack and the anglers. They were caught on the Sea Dragon. And Captain V.P. Brinson, his mate Jamie Rybell, and the folks who caught the fish from the Fido. It's a nice catch of wahoo, yellowfin tuna, and dolphin. If you'd like to send in one of your photographs to us or some video, you can send it to Carolina 92. WNHW 2402 Wrightsville Avenue, Nags Head, North Carolina 27959. And for the latest fishing reports, stay tuned to Carolina 92, WNHW 92.5 FM. How about this for a fish picture? It's not a new one. It was taken in 1951. The anglers are Gene Parker Curtis, Guy Midget, Camille Podolsky, Joni Etheridge, and Jewel Burris. The young captain, third from the left, is Omi Tillett. The fish were caught on Omi's boat running out of what was then called Dykstra's Marina, which is located on Roanoke Island at the end of the Washington Balm Bridge, very close to where Pirates Cove is today. The Dykstra's Marina is now gone, but Captain Omi Tillett is still fishing out of Oregon Inlet.
You'll not find any better food or atmosphere than at the Pier House Restaurant, located on the Nags Head Fishing Pier at milepost 12. The Pier House Restaurant opens at 6 a.m. with an affordable breakfast for the early riser. And for lunch, the Pier House Restaurant offers both a hot or cold lunch special. For dinner, enjoy ordering from their dinner menu or one of their all-you-can-eat seafood specials. The Nags Head Pier House Restaurant, milepost 12. Ocean View Dining, morning, noon, or night. We'll be right back.
Mateo Furniture Company in downtown Mateo is more than just your number one choice for home furnishings, because you'll also find Berbers and Salem Carpet, Mannington and Armstrong floor coverings for your home or office. Lori, an interior designer, will assist you with coordination and decorating ideas. They also carry Zenith and Sylvania TVs and VCRs, GE and RCA appliances, and factory-trained service departments. Mateo Furniture will even pick up your TV and return it when repaired. Several reasons why Mateo Furniture is still your number one choice for home furnishings and more.
Nags Head Hammocks, milepost 9.5 on the bypass in Kildevil Hills and milepost 10.5 on the beach road at Nags Head, has handcrafted woven hammocks and leisure furniture made on the premises. Nags Head Hammocks has that unique gift or that special accent of leisure furniture for your beach cottage or home. With shipping of any product, Nags Head Hammocks assures you of quality, durability, and workmanship of all their products. Nags Head Hammocks, milepost 9.5 on the bypass in Kildevil Hills and milepost 10.5 on the beach road in Nags Head.
The Mateo waterfront is indeed rich in history. Unlike today, commercial fishermen use sailing vessels called Sharpies to ply their trade. Clara's Seafood Grill and Steam Bar is proud of this heritage and is currently displaying a 20-foot scale model of a Sharpie. Clara's carries a long family tradition of serving only the finest food available, excellently prepared and served, including their new steamed bar. Awaiting you is a panoramic view of Shallowbag Bay and the Elizabeth II. So chart your course for Clara's Seafood Grill.
This is Carl and Zena Hazer. You know the Hazers. They've invited everybody to see their new business, Nags Head Florist. Carl and Zena arrange and deliver to their customers the freshest flowers available. With years of floral experience, they know what good service and quality products mean to their customers. So for that special occasion or a spur-of-the-moment flower that says, I'm sorry or I love you, call Nags Head Florist, 441-4861. Make Nags Head Florist your florist of choice on the Outer Banks.
Wanchese decoy maker Nicky Sapone will be featured in the August edition of North Carolina Wildlife Magazine. We visited with Nicky at his home in his decoy shop in Wanchese.
Let's see, I started making decoys in 1980, and probably 81 or 82 I started working on some canvas decoys. At first I started rebuilding an old canvas decoy, a goose, and I realized that I would just probably mess up an old decoy, so I made one like it instead, and it turned out all right. And the next few that I made turned out a little better. I was improving as I went along. I didn't know who to ask how these decoys are made. People are kind of secretive about these things if they're still around. Most of the old timers are gone now, but anyway, it was a lot of trial and error, and I was getting the feeling that I reinvented this decoy style because I had spent so much time trying to figure out the different problems of how to do them correctly. And there are several ways of making them, several different types of the wireframe canvas decoy. But anyway, I continued making them, and people started to notice, and they're wanting to buy them. So I didn't want to sell any of my decoys at first. I was just making them for myself. But eventually I started selling a few, and I improved my decoys considerably from that point. And I make several different head styles on the same general body style of the Canada goose. I make snow geese now. And then I started making swans, and then three-quarter size swans, and then ducks. There's an endless number of decoys that you can make out of canvas. And it's plenty of work, very time consuming. I designed my own decoys using the look and principles that the old decoy makers used in this area, but mine are completely my own design. And there's a lot of different steps involved, from laying out and carving the head. The head is the only carving part in this type of decoy, but it has to be, you know, has to look pretty good. The rest of it is just cut out parts that need to fit together correctly. The wires are all different lengths and different shapes. They all have to be bent to the proportion of the decoy that you're making. And I use string to hold the wires in place, which some of the old makers used. I try to use as many of the old processes and techniques that I can. I use oil paints. You can hunt with my decoys. They won't go to pieces or anything. So I use as many of the traditional methods as I can. There's a few shortcuts that I've figured out, but I suppose some of the old guys figured out some shortcuts too.
We asked Nick how Eddie Nickens of North Carolina Wildlife Magazine contacted him about being in the publication.
He had an interest in the canvas decoy type, and he told me that he contacted Neil Connolly, who is the author of Waterfowl Heritage, the book on local decoys. And Neil recommended him to me for the canvas decoys in particular. And he also said he contacted Archie Johnson in Virginia Beach, who also recommended me. So I'm kind of proud of that. And I hope I can uphold my end of this thing.
Again, look for Nicky and his decoys in the August edition of North Carolina Wildlife Magazine. Now, there's a new club on the Outer Banks. They don't meet. They don't have any annual dues. In fact, we're not really sure exactly what they do. But their membership is growing rapidly. The president of the High Tiders Club, or should I say Hoy Tiders Club, Randy O'Neill, shared a little bit with us about the organization.
I'm very proud of the heritage we have here on the Outer Banks, and our accent is a very important part of that heritage. And about 2 months ago, I started the High Tider Club. I found that traveling throughout the state that a lot of people really enjoyed hearing the people from the Outer Banks talk, and on quite occasions I've been requested to say high tide on the sound side. And I've also been called a high tider, so that's the background on the High Tider Club. The first members were taken in May of this year, and we have approximately about 200 members now, I believe. So it's growing, and we're having a lot of fun with it, you know.
If you think you qualify for membership in the Hoy Tiders Club, I think I said that right, didn't I? Hoy Tide on the sound side. There's no fee, but the pen costs $2. You can contact Randy O'Neill. Back in the 1800s on the mainland of Dare County, there was a city. It was called Buffalo City. The economy thrived around a sawmill and a lumber company. There were thousands of people that lived there. One of the modes of transportation in Buffalo City was a train. This is a picture of the Virginia Dare 1. You can see the name in the middle right-hand side of the picture. That's her crew standing and sitting in front of her. Notice the man on the far left with the black hat. He's holding a gun at someone. We're not sure who. In fact, we don't know who the people are in the picture, but we found it quite interesting. A bit of history from the mainland of Dare County. And we wanted to share it with you. Thank you for watching. Have a good evening.